Hi guys, my name's Tom Mills. I want to take a little time today to talk about biblical languages. I always find it funny that there's a lot of people willing to learn a second language to go on vacation somewhere. They're not willing to take the time to learn another language to read the Bible in its original language. We're content to leave preachers and seminary students with that honor. We were content to read our English versions, but yet we argue all the time over which English version is the best. Everybody's got a preference, NASB, NIV, King James. The reason why we have all these versions is because we can't agree, the translators can't agree on what the text actually says in the original language a lot of times. How much better it would be to be able to read the Bible in its own native language. There's actually over 900 English translations of the Bible alone. That's to show you just a little bit about how confusing some of the things can be, and in reality they're not that confusing. The words themselves are defined fairly easily in Greek. It's just a matter of making a sentence that agrees with what the author was probably trying to say. There's a lot of study benefits you can get from studying the Greek on your own. The scriptures tend to come alive a lot more. Quick note about some of the words I'll be using today. I follow the pronunciation method. It's called Reconstructed Biblical Greek or Roman period Koine Greek. It's taught by Randall Booth. Most seminary students, I bet you say, nearly 100% of all people who teach Greek or mention Greek as far as a Bible study goes, study what's called the Erasmian pronunciation. And funny thing is that the Erasmian pronunciation represents Greek at a time that was never spoken in the history of the language. So if you hear me say a word that is not how you originally had heard it said in the Greek, if you know any, have heard any Greek words before, that's why it'd be pronounced a little bit different. We'll go more into the pronunciation methods a little later. One of the main reasons I wanted to learn Greek is to find the biases in the translators. It's very common in all the translations to find certain biases one way or the other based on their own personal interpretations. King James has statements like, God save the king. And even though that wasn't really a good translation of it, that was a common phrase in their day. And so they put it in there, and it's really not a bad translation. But reading it in its original language can bring out a lot more. I also have heard teachers actually preach or watch videos where people will take a Greek word and they'll say, you think this Greek word means this. That's how it's translated in all your Bibles. But if you look in the Strong's Concordance, one of the ways it can be used is this obscure way. One of the words I had heard before is exousia, which means authority or power. But because of a certain bias that these people in the videos held, they would have wanted to translate it liberty. And they made exousia mean liberty, and so the scriptures aren't at all talking about obeying those in authority over us. It's talking about obeying those in a higher liberty over us, whatever that means. But either way, we should be able to know enough about the Greek that when someone tries to pull one over on us, we can say, no, that's not really what that means. Instead of, right now, if someone talks to you in Greek and says, this is what the Greek word is, they can tell you pretty much anything that follows, and you're going to believe them, even if it goes against modern translations. Give you an example. When I first learned to read Greek, before I even knew all the vocabulary, I went right to a passage of scripture that I was always somewhat confused about, and I knew there was more to the story, but if I could only figure it out. That's the story of Nicodemus coming to Jesus at night and asking him about how to be born again. Let me find that here, and we'll go in the scriptures and read it. Very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they're born of water and the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying you must be born again. The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but cannot tell where it comes from or where it is going. So is everyone born of the Spirit. And I understood pretty much what he was saying about being born again, not crawling back into the mother's womb as Nicodemus thought. But him mentioning after he says that, the wind, you can hear the sound of the wind, but you don't know where it's come from or where it's going. And I was like, what is Jesus saying? Does he want us to be unpredictable and no one knows what we're going to do next? Or what was his purpose there? And when I first started reading Greek, I wanted to go right to this passage. And when I read it, I got something very interesting. The Greek word there used for wind is pneuma. It means wind or breath or spirit. And all those words there are actually pneuma. So quite literally, what Jesus actually says in the Greek is, very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they're born of water and wind. That's actually what he says. It's how he uses the term wind that makes things confusing. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the wind gives birth to wind. You should not be surprised at my saying you must be born again. The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but cannot tell anyone where it has come from or where it is going. So is everyone born of the wind. So he is saying, the translation is good. He's meaning spirit. And he's drawing a correlation between the wind that blows and the spirit that's in us. It's the same word, though. And so Jesus here is being really poetic and talking about the wind inside us, our inner wind. In Hebrew, it's the same way with breath. But it means something a lot deeper when we realize that that's what he was saying. So there's lots of things, there's lots of those, and I'll probably come back to them later on, of all the different things that the Greek understanding can bring you, a much deeper learning of the scriptures. The first thing that you ask yourself when you're going to learn a biblical language is if you're going to learn, Hebrew or Greek. Hebrew or Greek. The Old Testament is written in Hebrew, and the New Testament is written in Greek. People assume today that the Jews in Jesus' day spoke Hebrew. So a lot of people want to learn Hebrew first. The Old Testament is written in Hebrew, and the Jews that are alive today in Israel speak Hebrew, and so that must have been the language they spoke in Jesus' day, right? But that's actually not the case. There's quite a lot of evidence that Hebrew isn't even spoken much, if at all, during Jesus' day. That may come as a surprise to a lot of you. But let's go over a little bit some of that evidence. Hebrew was originally lost in Babylon. Let's go back to just before they went into Babylon, in Isaiah 36:11. It's also in Kings, but I like the Isaiah one a little better. And Sennacherib has come to taunt Israel, coming down to destroy them. And he says to the field commander in verse 11, "Please speak to your servants in Aramaic, since we understand it. Don't speak to us in Hebrew on the hearing of the people on the wall." And the commander says, but the commander replied, "Was it only to your master that my master sent thee to say these things? And not to the people sitting on the wall, who, like you, will have to eat their own excrement and drink their own urine?" So that clearly most of the people at this time spoke Hebrew, but it's clear that the leaders did know Aramaic. Right after that is when Hezekiah shows the people from Babylon all the treasures in his house, and Isaiah tells him that all that will be taken by the people from Babylon. After they come out of Babylon, however, we can read in Nehemiah 13:23, "Moreover, in those days I saw men of Judah who had married women from Ashdod, Ammon, and Moab. Half the children spoke the language of Ashdod, or the language of one of the other peoples, and did not know how to speak the language of Judah." So after they come out of Babylon, this says here, half their children spoke the language of Ashdod, and the other half spoke one of the other languages and did not know how to speak the language of Judah. And here, shortly after that, we actually have the Bible written in Aramaic. Parts of Daniel and Ezra, when they're building the wall, is actually written in Aramaic, because that became the language of the day. That's the kind of language that they spoke. Also, in the New Testament is the use of the Septuagint, which is almost exclusively the Bible they quoted, and I can be willing to prove here that as the Bible they had at the time. There's lots of these. I'm just going to go over a couple of them, starting with the eunuch that Phillips talks to. I'm still not able to read Greek fluently enough to just open the Septuagint and start reading it in its original language. So I'm going to use a translation of the Septuagint that's worded in much the same way as the King James Bible is worded. I'm going to quote the New Testament, King James also, so it's all kind of the same style of phrasing. But in Acts 8:32-33, in the King James, Philip goes up to the eunuch and says, "Do you understand what you're reading?" And the eunuch says, "How can I unless someone explains it to me?" And then it says that he was reading from this portion of Scripture, and then what follows is a quote. And it says, "He was led as a sheep to the slaughter, and like a lamb dumb before his shearer, so he opened not his mouth. In his humiliation, his judgment was taken away. And who shall declare this generation? For his life is taken from the earth." So that's the King James Version. It's quoting Isaiah 53:7-8. But if you go back in the Hebrew Scriptures and all of our Bibles and read that passage, it never really quite matches up. And there's actually more stuff there than what the eunuch is talking about. Going back to Isaiah 53:7-8 from the King James, it says, "He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is dumb, so he openeth not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment, and who shall declare his generation? For he was cut off of the land of the living, for the transgression of my people he was stricken. So you can see it's quite a bit different. And I always thought, man, that is weird. But when I started comparing these in the Septuagint, it became a lot more clear. I'll put these on the screen so you can see the comparisons. In the Septuagint, Isaiah 53, 7 and 8, it says, he was led as a sheep to the slaughter, and as a lamb before the shearer is dumb, so he opens not his mouth. In his humiliation, his judgment was taken away. Who shall declare his generation, for his life is taken from the earth? It's nearly identical with Acts 8:32, King James in the English. If you look at the actual Greek words, every single word lines up but one, an extra hymn that's thrown in there. But short of that, it's word for word the exact translation from the Septuagint. And nearly all of them are that way. Every time the New Testament disciples quote the Old Testament, it almost always is... It is always referring to the Septuagint. Even the scroll Jesus reads in Luke 4, Jesus asked the synagogue rulers for the scroll of Isaiah, and they bring it to him, and he unscrolls it, and he starts reading from a certain part, quoting Isaiah 61. But if you look it up, it's the same thing. It doesn't fit the Hebrew scriptures at all, and it lines up with the Greek exactly. So even the scrolls and the synagogue were Septuagint scrolls. Likewise, the council in Acts with James quoting Amos 9. James quoting it doesn't seem to be reading from anything. He's pretty much quoting it from memory, it seems. But it's also straight from the Septuagint. It isn't Hebrew at all. So in use, in writing, in learning, in reading, they were using the Septuagint as their Bible. And the Septuagint is just the Greek version of the Hebrew scriptures. The Hebrew scriptures came first, and then later on... A king set out to want to have all the knowledge of the earth and knew the Jews had a big book. So he wanted them to translate it, and they chose 70 people to translate the scriptures. There's all kinds of fun legends about that. But either way, they translate it for him, and that's what the Bible that came to be used primarily in Jesus' day. In talking about the languages of the Bible, to further make the point, I believe Greek is almost, well, Greek was the exclusive language of the New Testament. All the books are written in there. Jesus spoke Greek. The Jews spoke Greek. All the people in the New Testament we see speaking Greek. Now, there are other languages there also. Aramaic was the primary language of lots of places, and Greek were the primary language of other places. But it's always listed as such in the Bible. One quick thing I wanted to mention is if you look in the NIV, it translates the word Aramaic lots of times. Let me bring one up. I'll start with John 19:13. It says, when Pilate heard this, he brought Jesus out and sat down on the judge's seat at a place known as the stone pavement, which in Aramaic is Gabbatha. But if you look like in the NASB, it says, which in Hebrew is Gabbatha. So the question is, why does the NIV mention it's the word Aramaic Gabbatha? And the word, and NASB used the word Hebrew. Which was it? Doesn't that evidence that they were speaking Hebrew? The actual Greek word is Hebraisti, which is Hebrew. That's the word, that's what it means. That's the word Hebrew. The thing is what follows saying in Hebrew is Gabbatha. Gabbatha is an Aramaic word. And in fact, all the times where another language is mentioned in the New Testament, all the famous ones you've heard about, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, Jesus said on the cross, Simon, who was named Cephas, Jesus was crucified at Golgotha, the pool of Bethesda, over and over again. All those words are Aramaic words, yet every time it's mentioned, it says Hebraisti, Hebrew. So the question becomes, why were they using Hebrew? But it becomes pretty obvious that that was the language that the Hebrews spoke. The Hebrew was primarily the race of people. And what language they spoke was usually Hebrew. But after Babylon, that was no longer the case. And that's a really good proof right there, John 19:13, which in Hebrew is Gabbatha, which Hebrew, Gabbatha is not Hebrew, it's Aramaic. Another good part is, or another place to mention that they weren't talking about Hebrew, the language, you can see in Paul's story when he's about to be confronted in Acts 21. Go there. starting in verse 37. It says, as the soldiers were about to take Paul into the barracks, he asked the commander, may I say something to you? Do you speak Greek? He replied. Aren't you the Egyptian who started a revolt and led 4,000 terrorists into the wilderness some time ago? Paul answered, I am a Jew from Tarsus in Cilicia, a citizen of no ordinary city. Please let me speak to the people. After receiving the commander's permission, Paul stood on the steps and motioned to the crowd. When they were all silent, he said to them in Aramaic. I'm reading the NIV. Brothers and fathers, listen now to my defense. If you look at the actual Greek for that, the actual phrase here you can kind of see here is Ibreisti dialecto. So it's literally translated the dialect of the Hebrews or the language of the Hebrews. Not at all talking about the Hebrew language, but the language which the Hebrew people spoke. This is beside the point that when Paul addresses the commander, he says, do you know Greek? You speak Greek? He was surprised that Paul spoke Greek at all. He thought he was the Egyptian. So the fact that Paul's dressed in Greek comes out as a little bit of a surprise, but obviously at this point, Paul's speaking Greek. If you continue on, it becomes even more clear. When they were all silent, he said to them in Aramaic, brothers and fathers, listen now to my defense. When they heard him speak in Aramaic, they became very quiet. So right away, you can tell Paul was speaking in Greek. These people are throwing dust over their heads, fighting, yelling, and screaming to where the commander of this regiment is going to take Paul away. And he starts to address him, and when I hear him speaking Aramaic, it's clear he changed languages at that point. So he went to the Hebrew language, the dialect of the Hebrews, the Hebrew people spoke, they get very quiet. It's clear that this was not a language they were used to hearing. And when they started hearing this, it shut them up, because it was obviously out of the ordinary. They were primarily speaking Greek, and that's what they would have been speaking, and when they hear Aramaic, they change. Which is strong evidence that Aramaic was even not all that common. It was primarily Greek that they were speaking. Further proofs. I have a couple other ones I want to look up. Cephas. Everybody knows that Simon's name was renamed Cephas. But Cephas is an Aramaic word for rock. But later on, Jesus uses the Greek name to refer to Peter and does a play on words. In Matthew 16:18, you know the story, Jesus says, you are Peter, and upon this rock I'll build my church. But if you look at the actual Greek there, it says, you are Petros, you are Peter, but upon this rock, Petra, I will build my church. Those are two different words. Petros is a rock you can hold in your hand. It's a wobbly rock, a rock you can throw. But Petra is a foundational rock. It's like a mountain, a giant, giant foundational rock. Hebrew and Aramaic have no correlation. They have a word for rock. They don't have one word for a movable rock and one word for a non-movable rock. They use only one thing. So here Jesus is obviously using the language of Greek to be poetic about his name and to do a little play on words, neither of which work in any other language, which just shows that Jesus was using the Greek here as well. So in addition to calling him Cephas, he also called him Petros, Peter. You also have Pilate, Pontius Pilate. When Jesus is brought before Pontius Pilate in John 19, Pilate takes Jesus into a room and starts questioning him. And it says that he's alone, and they're talking to Jesus, and he's saying, who are you, where do you come from, and all this stuff. So Pilate is talking directly to Jesus. Pilate was a Roman, so he would have definitely known Latin. It's very unlikely that he would have learned Aramaic, the language of the Jews, but he certainly must have known Greek. But what's interesting, after talking to Jesus, and Jesus talks to him, he goes out and he talks directly to the Pharisees, and the Pharisees talk back to him, and then he talks to the whole crowd, and then they talk back to him. So he's talking to the crowd, the Pharisees, and Jesus, all with one language, which is going to be Greek. That shows that the crowd spoke Greek, Jesus spoke Greek, and Pilate would have spoken Greek as well. Also, you get in Mark 5:40 and 41, Jesus is going to the house of the synagogue ruler, whose daughter had died, and Jesus was going to raise her from the dead. And it specifically says that they leave the Greek language at one point, and they say, so he said to the girl, Talitha kum, which is Aramaic for little girl, get up. And the little girl, you know, being the child of a synagogue ruler, wouldn't have known Greek. She likely just spoke Aramaic. So Jesus talks to her in Aramaic. But whenever something is said in Aramaic, the scriptures specifically tell us that he's speaking Aramaic. What's more likely, that it was all in Aramaic and they're just translating into Greek, or he primarily spoke Greek, and the times where he spoke Aramaic, they just tell us about it. In John, where am I? John 20, Mary goes to the tomb and she's crying, and the angels ask her, "Woman, why are you crying?" And she says, "They have taken my Lord away," she says, "and I don't know where they have put him." At this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. He asked her, "Woman, why are you crying? Who is it you were looking for?" Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you've carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will get him." Jesus said to her, "Mary." And she turned toward him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Rabboni is Aramaic for teacher. But what's interesting about this passage is that they mention that this word is in Aramaic. Clearly, up to that point, they had been speaking a different language. What word language were they speaking? Well, they're writing it all down in Greek. They were speaking Greek. And it wasn't until she's caught off guard and she's so excited that she cries out Rabboni, and that was probably her native language, but you know, Greek was the language of the day that she was speaking. You see the same thing with Jesus on the cross. Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. You know, here he is being tortured on a cross. If you were being tortured in another country, would you be thinking all that time, "Oh, how do you say pain in this language?" And then translate. Oh, there we go. But no, he's talking. When you're in pain, your natural language, your first language, comes out. And I think that shows that Jesus' first language was Aramaic, but the language that he spoke and he taught in was Greek throughout all this. Of course, the biggest testimonial that it's all in Greek is that every single book in the New Testament, every single letter, every single prophecy, word of encouragement, word of instruction, it's 100% entirely in Greek. We see no other languages anywhere else, certainly not any Hebrew. Occasionally we see Aramaic words scattered throughout the text, but everything we got is Greek. That's the biggest evidence of all. My point in doing all this is I want to be able to teach you how to speak Greek on your own. I've been learning Greek on my own for about 4 or 5 years now. And you don't have to go to seminary to learn Greek. In fact, I think if you go learn Greek in a seminary, you'll get messed up, at least because of pronunciation. When you go and you're reading something to yourself, even if you're just reading in your head, you still pronounce the word in your head. You know, you still say it, even if you don't speak it out loud. When you're reading it, you have to pronounce it some way in your head before you read it. And so the pronunciation makes a difference. And you know, the Erasmian pronunciation is... if you spoke Erasmian to a modern-day Greek person now, they literally are offended by it because it's so different from how their language is. They claim the Greek never spoke that way, and indeed, it never did speak. It was never spoken that way. I want to put in the comments some comments or a description. I'm going to put in a link to some flashcards that I used to learn the Greek letters. That's where you'd want to start. If you want to learn Greek, you start by learning the alphabet and learn how all the words, you'll recognize them, how they sound. You do that alone, just after doing that, in a very short time, you'll be able to read Greek. You may not know what you're reading, but you'll be able to read it. And then it just becomes memorizing vocabulary and then the endings, which can be a little confusing, but help us understand things. But well, I hope you guys enjoyed that. I'm going to have more videos on the topic coming up and teach you how to go learn Greek for yourself and be able to keep all those teachers honest, and much more to bring out a fuller view of the scriptures in our hearts and aids your study greatly. Thanks.